So my name is Elliot Figman. I'm the executive director at Poets and Writers, and I'm pleased to welcome you, very pleased to welcome you to today's event. Poets and Writers Live is a brand new initiative that we developed in response to discussions we had with writers from all over the country. When we asked them what more could poets and writers do to help you, time and again they told us that they wanted more opportunities to meet with other writers face to face. So we came up with a living, breathing version of what we offer in Poets and Writers Magazine and on our website, pw.org. And here we have it, Poets and Writers Live. This is the second Poets and Writers Live event. It's the first we've done in New York City. So you are all part of history. We have a full day of panel discussions and readings and conversation planned for you. I hope you come away from this better informed and more committed than ever to your writing. And it's my pleasure now to turn it over to Bonnie Rose Marcus, who for the past 14 years has run our readings and workshops and writers exchange programs here in New York. Bonnie.
Thank you. So, welcome everybody. It's so great to see everybody here on this beautiful day. I'm really honored to be moderating this panel, How to Sustain a Writing Life, with four fabulous writers. I'm going to give a brief introduction, and then I will introduce each of the all the panelists together at the beginning. They will speak for about 10 minutes each, and then we'll have a little bit of time for some questions and answers. So I wanted to start by talking a little bit about the Readings and Workshops program, which I'm not sure everybody here knows about, but it was actually how Poets and Writers started in 1970 with a simple but very progressive idea of paying writers to give readings of their work or conduct workshops. So it started with a small amount of events, maybe 20 or 25, and it's grown where we fund about 1,000 writers supporting 1,800 events in New York State, in California, and in 8 other cities: Atlanta, Chicago, Detroit, New Orleans, Tucson, Seattle, and Washington, D.C. The program really is really about the diversity of writers. We fund both professional and emerging writers to do readings and workshops in all sorts of venues, not just your traditional readings and workshops that maybe what you think about as libraries or bookstores, but we do events in senior centers, in youth centers, at prisons, with people dealing with AIDS, in homeless shelters. So it's very diverse in that way, as well as the writers we support from all ethnicities. Time and again, we hear from writers how valuable it is to get paid for giving a reading or conducting a workshop. Not merely for the monetary value, because they're small, they're modest grants, but for it validates a writer. It says that literature is important, that we need writers to enhance our world and our lives. So the idea for this panel came from talking to so many writers who over the years have struggled or are challenged with figuring out how to sustain their writing life and support themselves and their families. When you think about it, most professions have a trajectory that goes from work done to reimbursement given. Carpenters get paid for making cabinets, nurses for caring for patients, car mechanics for fixing cars, and so on. But not true for writers, or at least not all writers. So even though we as writers spend countless hours sitting in a room in front of our computer or with a pad of paper, reading, having ideas brew in our mind to create a poem, a story, or an essay, or a book, more than often or not, we're not always reimbursed for our work. But we keep at it because as writers, we're compelled to write. So how do we choose livelihoods that have meaning to us, that reinforce or nurture our work as writers, or that enable us to balance our lives so we can pursue our art with integrity and without burning out? We need models of dedicated writers who have found a way to support their writing life, found meaningful livelihood that inspires, supports, or invigorates their writing. All of our panelists have varied livelihoods. Some teach, some edit, some run organizations, serve on boards, have families, administer programs. And so I asked them a series of questions. What do you do to sustain your work as a writer? How did you come to figure this out? How do you balance the challenges or demands of your day or other jobs with your writing life? What have you learned in terms of navigating this for yourself? And what advice do you have for writers who are trying to figure this out? So I will at this time read the bios of our writers, and then they will speak to some of these questions. Tina Chang, we're going in alphabetical order. Tina Chang is the Brooklyn Poet Laureate, author of the poetry collections Half-Lit Houses and Of Gods and Strangers. She is also co-editor of the anthology Language for a New Century, Contemporary Poetry from the Middle East, Asia, and Beyond. She teaches poetry at Sarah Lawrence College and is also a member of the International Writing Faculty at the City University of Hong Kong, the first low-residency MFA program to be established in Asia. Rigoberto Gonzalez is the author of 4 books of poetry, most recently Unpeopled Eden. His 9 books of prose include 2 bilingual children's books, the 2 young adult novels in the Mariposa Club series, the story collection Men Without Bliss, the novel Crossing Vines, and 3 books of nonfiction, Butterfly Boy, Memories of a Chicano Mariposa, which won the American Book Award from the Before Columbus Foundation. He's also edited many anthologies, including Camino de Sol, 15 Years of Latina and Latino Writing. He's received the Guggenheim and NEA Fellowships, a NYFA grant in poetry, the Shelley Memorial Award from the Poetry Society of America, and the Barnes & Noble Writer for Writers Awards. He is a contributing editor for Poets and Writers Magazine and on the board of directors of the National Book Critics Circle. He is currently Associate Professor of English at Rutgers Newark, the State University of New Jersey. Karma Mayet Johnson is a multidisciplinary performer, poet, composer, educator, and mystic. Her poems have appeared in ExitTheApple.com, Nocturnes, Cave Canem's Gathering Ground, Redbone Press, Voices Rising, and elsewhere. She holds an MFA in poetry from New York University and was a 1998-2000 fellow of the Cave Canem Workshop Retreat for African American Poets. She was managing editor of Calabash, a journal of Caribbean arts and letters, and co-editor of the anthology Same Blood, Voices of Barrio Youth. She has worked as an arts educator in numerous settings and currently as a writing liaison at the Saturday program of Cooper Union School of Art. And Rich Vallar is the author of Comprehending Forever, his first collection of poems from Willow Books. He's directed Acentos in the Bronx, an organization fostering audiences and community around Latino, Latina literature. He's been quoted on Latino literature and culture by both the New York Times and the Daily News, and his poetry and essays have appeared or are forthcoming in Black Renaissance Noir, Hanging Loose, Beltway Poetry Quarterly, and Sue Wester. So without further ado, I'll turn us over to our panel, and we'll start with Tina Chang.
Hello, can you hear me? Well, I thought it was really important to share some stories with you that I have never shared with anyone, not even close friends. So 3 years ago, I was 6 months pregnant with my daughter. And as I headed to an interview to be considered as part of the core faculty for a new international writing program in Hong Kong, that morning I stood confronting myself in the mirror asking if I would be hired as a teacher in a new MFA program. A new program I would assume would require many hours of preparation and communication and also travel abroad to teach. I felt many sides of myself at odds. I'd be giving birth to a baby in a few months' time. Wouldn't it be beneficial to both myself and my newborn to stay by her side for the first few months as a mother without the pull of job and career? Then again, as a working writer, wasn't it my responsibility to take care of my family? I looked at the stack of bills growing on my dining room table. I buttoned my blazer, which puckered at the belly, put on my oversized coat, and left for my interview in the snow. When I arrived at the meeting, the director of the writing program, who is also an old friend, asked me, "What's new?" I could have taken off my coat. I could have told her, another woman, all about the excitement of being expectant. Instead, I kept my coat on and never breathed a word about my pregnancy. I moved forward with the interview as we spoke about the possibilities of the new writing program and that it was the first of its kind in Asia. We both grew very excited about the international faculty and also the students who would fly from around the world to convene in Hong Kong for workshops, lectures, readings, classes, community. And by the end of our talk, it was clear that I was hired for the job. As we embraced one another to say goodbye, I made sure to keep some distance between our bodies so that she wouldn't notice that I was growing with child. As I walked home, I felt a battle within myself. I wondered why, at the last minute, I chose to hide my pregnancy. I'd hoped for a child for almost 2 decades. As a woman, I felt it was a blessing, and as a working writer, I wasn't entirely sure a baby would be seen as a benefit in a field that is competitive as any other. In short, if I fully revealed my life as a brand new mother, I wasn't sure I would have gotten the job. This situation is among many in which I've had to negotiate as a writer, as a teacher, as a public speaker, as a servant to the borough of Brooklyn, as its poet laureate. On a daily basis, I must make difficult choices. What it means to sustain myself is a complex issue, as the act of sustaining oneself is no longer sustaining an entity of one, but a family which is comprised of many. Often, my creative self calls to me. Like a lover calling to me from across a valley, I must think carefully about the daily journey of reaching that creative self. On the other side of the valley might be my real life. There, my children are running frantically through my living room. They are covered in various sauces, asking for TV, oatmeal, a change of underwear, and something much more fun and exciting than what I'm offering at the moment. On the other side of my wanting, they are sometimes sick, they are sometimes fearful, and they have needs that must be answered immediately. As I run toward that set of responsibilities, how can my creative life be sustained? Sometimes that creative self is left standing among the valley, wondering where the lover has gone. Why is she late? Why is the sun going down? Or why didn't she show up at all? There's a piece of writerly advice that is mentioned often. Show up to your desk every day. In some people's lives, this is just not possible. However, it is absolutely essential to the creative spirit to try. My office is around the corner from my house, which means I must leave my apartment to get there. It is only one block from my home, but sometimes it feels as if I'm making a transatlantic flight to get there. In the first few months of giving birth, I must admit, my office was empty. As much as I tried, after feeding, changing, entertaining my baby, and keeping a home looking as if someone sane lived there and on little sleep, I often drifted off to bed just to get an hour or two of shut-eye before I had to wake up and do it all over again. It was in these instances when I wondered if I would ever write again. Often, I would have an idea, and I would remind myself to develop an idea before my infant's cry interrupted that. It was, however, after a few months' time, a message came to me, and it was a very important message. The voice said, "Put on your shoes." You see, if I could just place my shoes on my feet, that was the first step to reaching my office. If I could reach my office, I could open my laptop. If I could open my laptop, I could begin typing out a few ideas. Perhaps those ideas would develop into poems, and perhaps those poems would eventually become part of a larger manuscript, and perhaps that larger manuscript would become a book, and that's exactly what happened. Even now, each day is a careful negotiation of what to do and what not to do, and with every day, one question must be answered. What is truly essential? Each person will answer this question differently, as the idea of essentialism is an individual one. Often in my life, what is truly essential is making sure my family is fed and safe. After that, what is essential is ensuring that I honor my writing life. If I can fulfill my purpose, this is a good day. I wish I could say that I had a daily routine that gives structure to each calling, but I don't. Often I will dash to my office when I can. If I'm lucky, I might have an entire day to write. Most days, I may have an hour where I find myself furiously typing out ideas that I'd been holding in my imagination all week. I try often to forgive myself and to take the valuable minutes that I have to live the writer's life in whatever form or shape it takes that day. So I want to end on a story, also one that I had never told anybody. I've been working for a long time on my second collection of poetry called Of Gods and Strangers. And at the same time, I was editing a Norton anthology, which Bonnie had mentioned. And both projects fed me and took, it felt, years out of my life. On the night that I was celebrating my second book collection, I had bought a brand new dress, and this is very important for a woman. I brought a dress for the occasion, and it was this indigo chiffon dress with these subtle flowers at the collar. And as I was readying myself to leave my apartment, I held my daughter. And for a moment, just for a moment, I felt like I had it all. I was officially a published writer and a working mother. I was celebrating my published collection that evening, and my entire family was going to be by my side. And as I quietly celebrated myself, an awful smell erupted from my self-congratulatory fantasy, and I realized that the foul smell was coming from my daughter. She had soiled her diaper, everything was dripping from her clothes, and some of it onto my brand new dress. All I could do was take off my dress, throw it in a pile in the living room, turn on the water, and run the bath for my daughter, and for now, my book party had to wait. Thank you so much.
Buenos dias, good morning. Growing up, I did not have any, even a fantasy of entering what we now call the writer's life. I think that I knew that I wanted some kind of association with books and literature because that's where I found the most comfort in terms of finding refuge, finding a haven from the other urgencies surrounding my family growing up in a migrant farm working community. Even when I entered, when I pursued an MFA, and I heard other people fantasize about the writer's life, I still didn't think that was for me. I thought, well, you know, I don't have those models. I don't know what that means exactly, except that there is this relationship with books and with writing. So I thought, well, the closest I can come to that kind of relationship is being a teacher. So I thought I would be a teacher. But while being a student, I realized that for many writers in writing programs, being a teacher meant so much sacrifice. Being a teacher meant that they were going to commit so much time to their students, time that they probably, even without admitting to it, would rather spend on their own writing. So I resolved then and there that I was not going to pursue a teaching career. Somehow I was going to make a go at it doing other things. What those other things were, I didn't know until I actually fell into it. So for many years after graduating from a Master's of Fine Arts program, I did all kinds of odd jobs. I was a literacy specialist at an after-school program. I was a translator at the now-defunct St. Vincent's Hospital, where they paid me $30 a page and gave me everything in 10-point font, but that's okay. I taught Spanish to adults who wanted to learn the language at the Garment District in New York City. All kinds of, and everything seemed to at least give me the kind of experience that I thought a writer should have. Engaging with life, engaging with community, engaging with people, with place, even though the things that I wrote about were in another country entirely, Mexico. But there was something about engaging with that kind of energy that really fueled it. When I won my first award, my first publication, even then, even though I had met so many people that were living here in New York City, outside of academia, outside of the teaching profession, even they were encouraging me, well, now this is your way in. Now you can become a teacher, now you can, and I still resisted that. What did I do when I was 29 years old and I received this nice big grant called the Guggenheim, and everybody thought, save the money, invest it, get a teaching job. I said, screw that. I'm going to go and explore the world. The one experience that was always denied to me because I didn't have that kind of money, because teaching an after-school program, teaching Spanish, translating documents did not give me those kinds of luxuries. So I traveled the world. I went to Spain, I went to Italy, I went to Costa Rica, I went to Brazil, I went to Scotland, places that even in my wildest imaginations I didn't think I would reach. Do I write about those things? No, it took about 20 years for me to write about those experiences, but those experiences are there. And I didn't know at the time that I was making that kind of investment. And I appreciate now that I did make that kind of investment. I don't know, perhaps if I had gone into a teaching job 20 years ago, I might have other things to write about. My imagination might have taken a different direction, but I'm not gonna worry about that. I'm simply gonna take what was given to me with this opportunity to see the world at a very young age and to begin to explore and to begin to generate from it an idea of myself as not just a writer, but as a citizen of the world. I knew that I was engaging with the world through literature, but now I was engaging it very physically as I visited these places. So why did I end up in a teaching profession after all that? Well, the other sort of cautionary tale, and this is something that I learned in New York City as well, was so many aging writers that had to, this is before the whole Obamacare, you know, era, who were suffering with dealing with health issues and not having health insurance, which was an important consideration, especially as you get older. My own health began to fail about 10 years ago, so I thought, well, this is it. I'm gonna have to really seriously consider going into a teaching job for the health insurance. Don't tell my students. I love teaching. It's been a wonderful experience. It's still something that I navigate and I rethink, especially when the days are filled with other kinds of obligations like meetings, very boring and long and useless meetings with mentorship one-on-one with our students, which is always the fun part. In fact, right after this, I'm gonna meet with a number of my students to do a little check-in for the summer. I learned that that kind of interaction was also important to me. I've had that interaction in the city, attending readings, meeting with friends of mine who are writers. But I also understood that that took time. That took that was another kind of commitment. I'm single, I don't have children, I don't even have plants, which is kind of nice. But, so that gives me another kind of luxury. But I have to keep somehow engaged. Another cautionary tale is becoming the isolated writer, which I also witnessed and saw here in New York City. People that were so protective of their time that they didn't engage and they weren't generous citizens of this landscape. And that's something that I've always been very careful to be part of, is that if I'm gonna be part of this world, if I'm gonna be taking from this world, everything from experience to moments of interaction, that I'm also gonna be giving back to the same world. I don't begrudge anybody that doesn't make that decision, but certainly that's something that I decided I would do, that I was gonna give back to this world that had given me so much, the literary landscape, which is why I do the kinds of things that I do. Not only do I write my books, but I'm also a book reviewer. I've been on the National Book Critics Circle for 8 years, which has been a lot of fun. It's a lot of free books, but it's a lot of responsibility in terms of shaping the tastes of what is considered award-worthy literature. And mentoring, as I said earlier, is very important. I did not come through this journey alone. I had plenty of help. I had plenty of people who were there to, at the very least, buy me some coffee, buy me a meal, listen to those moments where I didn't feel I was going anywhere, those moments of frustration, which are part of the writer's journey at every moment, but also the triumph, somebody that will recognize my triumphs, recognize my successes, and keep cheering me on. All that's part of it, all that is part of it. What's next for me in terms of moving into this next stage, which is, I hate the term, but now as a veteran, I have no idea. So like I didn't really go to war, but it's a veteran writer. And it just means that I've been in this trenches for 15 years. I didn't realize that there was another consideration, is the writers that are part of the landscape, part of the energy, and then disappear. I didn't want to be that writer either. I didn't want to be that writer who made so much investment that somehow was silenced by who knows what. That's why I keep going at it. I keep participating in the field. I keep looking forward and looking at the next generation who also need to look at me, right? Who also needs to recognize that I am engaging with them, interacting with them. I'm listening to them as much as they're listening to me. So if I can met out some advice that's hopefully practical to anybody here, is to understand what kind of commitment you're gonna make with the writing world, what kind of commitment you're gonna make with other writers. I think that the writer who is not generous is a writer who is not gonna have the kinds of champions who are gonna keep that person from disappearing, from vanishing. I'll end it at that. Thank you.
Good morning. So I'm curious as to, before I speak at length, I'm curious as to who's in the room. So like, how many of you all are New Yorkers? Okay, good, so that makes sense. And then how many are parents? Okay. And how many are teachers? Okay, all right. Okay, so that's some gaps I don't have to fill in. That's what I wanted to know, okay. So this is my, oh my goodness, is this is 2014? Good.
Yes, it is 2014.
That's crazy. So I moved to New York City in 1999 to be a rock star. It's going pretty well. But the first thing was, right, I wanted to show up knowing that somebody would have like a check waiting for me. So the scheme was to go to grad school, right? That was the idea. So the biggest thing, the biggest sustaining factor in my life period, I mean, I'll say, of course, personally, we know that this is true, but really professionally, is the level of community connection. I mean, you know the cliche is like, it's who you know, whatever, right? But not just in terms of a hookup, but in terms of how you know what you're doing every day, why you're doing it, who you're doing it for, and who cares. Because those are the things you need to know so that you won't go crazy and so you'll keep doing your work, right? So, how many of you are engaged in or with a group of writers doing, you're doing workshops or you're doing, you have a crew, right? And how many of those are economically, you know, I mean, are you paying somebody? Are they paying you? Like, is there money involved? Is it transactional or non-transactional stuff, right? Because the non-transactional stuff is where it's at, right? Some of the connections that are here, right? When I was a little younger writer, one of the umpteen thousand freelance gigs I was doing at the same time, I will say, okay, so I'm 40 years old, and when I was 23, for 2 years, I had a full-time job. It's the only time in my adult life I've done that thing. So, yeah.
Talk about veteran.
So one of those gigs I had, right, was with poets and writers. I was doing workshops in the neighborhoods with the kids. We were writing poems, making beautiful artifacts along the way. And then cycling back around like about a decade later, almost-ish, maybe, to reconnect with them because they are now supporting one of the programs that I work with in the city that Bonnie mentioned, which is the Saturday program at the Cooper Union School of Art. So the cross-pollination is the second part that I really wanted to dig into. For me, it's been because I work in different disciplines, because I work really extensively as a performer in other people's theater pieces and operas and things, and then I make my own. I have been writing stuff for the stage. I've been writing songs. I've been writing all these sort of in these other areas and not waiting for someone to say it's okay, which is a different kind of process, right? From like sending out 100 things to people and waiting for none of them to publish you, right? So it's a sort of a different path, which is, I guess, why we want to spread out the conversation a little bit today. So, having said that, I went through the adjunct treadmill, right, which probably I imagine a lot of us in the room have been on. So there were times when maybe I was at 5 campuses in a week. You know, I think at one point, I think I was at Cooper and Rutgers and CUNY and like two other, I can't even, at the same time, New Rochelle and like all at the same time, bouncing around like a crazy person. And then I was talking to one of my colleagues at Rutgers who had been doing this for like 6 years, I think she said, that she had been riding that train, which cost us 4 hours of our lives every day, okay, to Jersey. And I was looking at her and I was thinking, she looks good, but I'm not gonna do it for 6 years, like without, you know, a tenure track. I mean, I'm just gonna get real with everybody this morning, okay, right? Because, please. So, it's about, I guess, what everyone I feel is echoing. It's about what you're willing to give up and what you're not willing to give up. I don't have any babies. I travel around a lot internationally, so I was always like not willing to commit myself to showing up for anybody like every day in the same room. But at the same time, you know, what have I given up? Well, I think that in terms of this question about, you know, juggling what's important and figuring out how to make the ends meet, one of the things that has been amazing is the different walks. So my mother teases me because when I show up in a room, like a room like this one, you know, I'll know like the security guard, the person who's introducing everyone on the panel, and like, you know what I mean? The person like outside in the elevator who's doing, how do you, who? Okay, so I talk to everybody everywhere. I try to remember, I am really bad with names, but I remember faces. Thinking about like the thousands and thousands of other people's children who I've helped to raise as an educator, I think about running into them all over the city. And I don't necessarily need to remember, right? You just hear like, professor, and you turn around, right? You're like, okay. But this just happened this week, which was really exciting, is that one of my old babies, I called them my babies, from like 7 years ago, found me. I have no idea how he tracked me down, and he's teaching in the Bronx right now. And he was like, you know, that poetry course out in New Brunswick, you know, I keep that in my mind all the time. As a teacher, I really want to provide these kids with this array of who American writers are. Like, you differ us in that class, and I am really trying to like push for some initiatives in my school, and I want to know if you will advise me in this process. And I da da da. So you know, you get that too. You get the fact that as you walk around spreading your seeds, some of them fall on good ground, and they come back to you. So it's just really important to have faith in that when you are in the valley, and you're trying to figure out how to pay this New York City rent. I also have the advantage of the fact that I was able to sort of fly a little in a little risky way because I landed in the same stabilized apartment in New York City for going on 15 years, right? So that's part of it too. I don't have any roommates. Imagine if like never had one. That's like never, ever, never. Isn't that crazy? That's crazy, right? So, a lot of the last word the first line of the bio says mystic. So that's a lot of it too. Prayer. Okay, in a serious way and atheist prayers work too. As long as you do them. I wanted to not talk as long because I wanted to talk with you longer at the end. So I figured if I kept my talk shorter, that would give all of us a few more extra minutes at the end. But I'm gonna look because there's a few things on my little notes that I wanted to not miss. Oh, right, the program. This is a full circle thing too, because talking about community, the Saturday program that Poets and Writers is collaborating with right now is 45 years old, so it's a little older than me, and it's something I was able to come into as a young writer in the city and be sustained to a certain degree. I have recently, within the last 2 months, taken on my first ever since I was like 22 or something, my first ever what I call civilian job, right? So, but I did it under the specification though, that although it comes with a full-time salary, it does not come with an office or a schedule. This is a miracle. This is why I say prayer works. Because this is what I said I needed to conjure. I mean, it takes time, of course, and it's about it came through a seed that I planted over a year ago without knowing that it was gonna come to fruition a couple months ago, because I had given it up, right? You put it in, then you give it up, and then you keep going, and then you see what happens. So all things are possible. Hustle, hustle, hustle. We know the grind. But taking care of ourselves and also refusing, I think refusing is a really important thing that I suggest. Refusing to do what you think will grind you down because you're right. Refusing to let go of the things that you know are going to increase your fortitude and your certainty of why it is that you have this work to get done. We often hear people repeating the same thing, that what you have to say, nobody else is able to. You, I think, are more likely not to lose sight of that the more you're engaged with helping somebody else do that, right? So that's why the first thing I asked was whether like everybody's in a collective of some sort. So I'll stop for now there, I think. And then I hope, because I'm stopping there, you guys will have some questions for me after, or for us. Yeah.
Okay. All right. I feel wholly unqualified to speak after a genuine mystic speaks. I've known Karma a long time, and it's, I have a question for you too, and I'm going to try to keep this as brief as possible, because to have this many teachers in one space and on the panel is an interesting thing, and I think that energy needs to be used. How many of you have homeowner's insurance? Oh, yes.
Ooh, that's great.
The mark of a grown-up indeed. Homeowner's insurance. Jobs. No. I know you have jobs. I'm talking about my jobs. that was funny. That was deep. How many of you pay flood insurance on those homeowners insurance policies? Okay. I used to be the guy who would determine if your property fell in a flood zone. My job was to make big maps into little maps and to compare them to the printed panels that FEMA puts out and determine whether or not your property is going to be, whether you're going to be paying another couple of $1,000s a year to insure against flooding. If you're lucky, sometimes it's more than that. In addition, I was a rental manager. I was the guy who chased you down for your rent and took you to court if you didn't pay. I was the office manager at a preschool. My first day on the job, a little three-year-old came up to my desk, and this was January, right? Because I started mid-year. She came up to my desk, she looked at me, she's a blank stare, and then just went, achoo. And just kept on staring. Like it was the cutest thing ever. This was my introduction to early childhood education. I worked in a warehouse. I used to stock the shelves at Sears, Best Buy. I was a retail maven. I was for a little while the director of a traffic safety program. My job was to basically march up and down the high trafficked areas in the state of New Jersey and determine literally, because this was a targeted program, to determine ways in which fewer Latinos could die in traffic accidents, pedestrian accidents. Because we die in disproportionate numbers because we don't have cars. At least in the areas where I worked. And all of these things, though they were definitely nourishing for the poems, didn't necessarily feed my writing life. And this is not to say that these are not worthwhile pursuits. Definitely at the early childhood stage, I mean, you know, you're talking about, you get to interact with 3 and 4 year old babies every day and it's just unbelievably nourishing for your soul. But it didn't leave me with a lot of time to write because I had to worry about, okay, this one is allergic to peanuts and this one, 180 kids in the class, in the school. This one's allergic to peanuts, this one needs an EpiPen, this one don't like it when you refer to her by her this name or the other, you know, it's all kinds of stuff, don't worry about. In the middle of all of that, I was directing a program called Acentos. And Acentos has its mission of sort of bringing a spotlight to Latino writers on a grassroots level. What I mean by grassroots is that we did it basically for free. And while that also had its rewards, it didn't feed me either. And this is not to say that you shouldn't do it. In fact, I still do my activism within the literary community. But, well, my hero is this guy named Harlan Ellison. How many of you have seen this YouTube video called Pay the Writer? Yeah. So Harlan gets on there, and you know, Harlan is Harlan, right? And it is a manifesto for those of us who are in the, you know, in the business of, you know, writing, freelancing. What happens in the mind of an activist is you say to yourself, okay, this work is the stuff I do to enhance my community, to enhance the world, and you don't mind, quote unquote, if you don't get paid for it. You say, well, this I'm giving back. And you do, you absolutely do. And then you say, you separate it and you say, okay, well, this stuff is the stuff that feeds me and you know, I will keep the two separate. I'm here to tell you that that's probably not the way, at least for me, that I'm ever gonna go again. If I'm going to have a 9-to-5 job, it's going to be something that is directly related to writing in some way. And what I mean by that is you don't necessarily have to be writing poetry or writing prose. You could be doing copywriting. You could do that document translation that we all, you know, dread so much, that which I've done for about 10 years or so. You can do all kinds of things that relate directly to writing. As long as you sort of keeping in the mode of putting something on paper every day. You know, that for me is important. And I charge money for what I do. You know, I've kind of given up the idea that this has to be the altruistic free thing that I do. And just simply say, well, you know, I have, my time is valuable. And if there is knowledge that you need, I'm here to give it, but there is an exchange that has to be done. Whether that exchange is in kind, whether it's, you know, you do this, I do this for you, that's fine too. But there has to be some sort of, you know, exchange happening, at least for me. I've gone 11 years doing it, you know, for no money. And it's okay, but I feel like I've been down that road and now I'm here. And it's important to put value on it. We don't want to. We what's the word? I'm kind of going into my own mysticism, I think. There's something counterintuitive about it. We say, well, you know, we shouldn't be paid for this. Well, yeah, you should. It's your time, it's your effort, it's your brain power, and it's your community. Your community deserves to have someone who values themselves, right? That having been said, the mission of Acentos for the last 11 years has entailed bringing a spotlight to Latino writing. It's entailed bringing it in particular to the Bronx, into a neighborhood which over the years has been considered blighted, has been considered Mott Haven, right? This is an area that it's been gentrified, it's been ungentrified, and then it's been gentrified again. There's all kinds of history there. But one part of the history that's not usually told is that there was a lady for whom we have named a medal at the American Library Association in Pura Belpre. Pura Belpre used to go around to the branches in Harlem and in the South Bronx and storytell to the largely immigrant population at the time, largely Latino population at the time, and tell them stories from their own culture to give them value. And we're talking about, this is the 1930s and 40s, right? And we made a specific choice when we started the reading series. And Acentos has gone through so many different incarnations. We've been a reading series. We are now a journal. Reina Leon edits our journal. It's called the Acentos Review. And we have been a workshop, a free workshop. So it's gone through many different incarnations. And in the fall, it will be a blog for political writing by Latinos, right? But we made a specific choice to locate right where we were because we knew the history of that neighborhood. And we knew to fill in the blanks. And our mission has always been to fill in the blanks of history, to complicate the story, and to, you know, to make the invisible visible, and to bring that sort of, ethic to what we did in terms of our programming, in terms of the open mics, the features. We featured, you know, a ton of Latino writers in our time, and we've published a ton of Latino writers in our time, and we've made this community, at least we've tried, we've made this community visible. And that mission sort of dovetails with my own. And I want to continue doing that. And I want to continue doing that in my community. And the other part of it, and this is where I think where I'll end, the other piece of it is writers today do everything, it seems, sometimes except write. We are on social media. And believe me, if you ever read my Facebook feed, it's pretty epic. I'm on that joint every day, and Twitter as well, and that's fun, you know, and it gives you something of like a presence, I guess. But it's more than just, you know, your social media. It's more than just your marketing plan. I once went to a panel of writers, and you know, I foolishly believed that we were going to talk craft that day. But it seemed that the only conversation that was happening in that particular space was about how to position your story, how to market your story, and there was no mention of poetry because, you know, poets don't really exist. You know, they get one shelf, half a shelf at Barnes & Noble if we're lucky, right? So it was all about how to position this particular story, my particular memoir, and that was the craft talk. Now, it had been labeled as a craft talk. And the craft talk began to talk about commercialism and marketing. You know, and we got to sit down and write. Because apart from all else, it's another thing that gives us value. If I'm going to go into the community and say, hey, you know, you should pay me for a workshop. You should give me $300 for the next 8 weeks, and I will meet with you one-on-one. And then, you know, I lay out my resume, and, you know, I've been published in Podunk Journal, and that's about it. Not to say that you shouldn't publish in small places. You should, obviously. But, you know, you have to bring something to the table if you're going to ask people to pay you money. And the way you do that is to write and to work and to remember why you do this thing. So, yeah, you know what? It's hard to find the time to put the words on the paper. But, man, that's your bread and butter right there. You cannot go forward in this world as a writer unless you publish the material, unless you publish the book. My first book came out in February. It's been 11 years. And I have to tell you, I put a lot on the back burner to live the life I was living. And unfortunately, one of the things I put on the back burner was my writing. And a few years ago, I said, no, this is what I need to do. And I just, you know, move forward with it. And sometimes that's the hardest thing to do, to put yourself first, you know, because it seems selfish. But I assure you, it is not. I got a call the other day from a young man who did, you know, kind of the same thing I did. And his passion was so acute, and he wanted to work in his community. And he kind of put the cart before the horse. And I told him, you know, my man, you have to put the words on the paper. You have to write. You have to get your work out there. And I think I'll stop there. But it is about valuing yourself, you know, valuing yourself, because without that, no one else will. And that's it.
Okay, so we just have a little bit of time, but maybe, so if there are a couple of questions, we'd have a time for a few, just a few, in about four minutes or so.
I think that differs for everyone. I had a friend who worked very heavily in poetry programming for about 10 years, and she started off in the beginning as a writer. But then after all of that heavy, intense poetry programming, she actually wound up quitting the poetry life altogether. I remember recently we had a reunion among a group of writers, and she was a part of the group that we all graduated from Columbia with an MFA. And we asked her what she was doing now after she quit that poetry life. And she said, oh, I work for 311. And I said, oh, 311, is that a literary magazine? She said, no, 311, like if you have a problem in the city, you have a pothole, you call me, I answer. Part of that made me extremely sad, because I know that whatever she started off with when we were all young students together was that she started off with the seed. You remember, you mentioned that word seed. She started off with the seed of loving writing, and somewhere along the way, I think because of her intensive organization in the name of poetry, in the name of writing, she became a little bit exhausted. But everybody handles it differently. I do teach, and I teach here, and I teach abroad. I'm not going to lie, I think on certain days it's really exhausting, because it's not just the teaching, it's the people that I'm teaching. They all have their own lives, and they bring their lives to the table, and it gets incredibly intricate. Many of them not only bring their work to the table, but just their lives and everything that's involved with it then also comes to me, and that can be very spiritually heavy. But I recently told somebody, and then I come home, and then I might have to do a reading that evening, and it's very multi-layered, but I told someone recently that I feel that there's a door within myself that when I need it most, when I need to pull even more out of myself, to create my own work that at this point, because of many, I wouldn't necessarily call myself a veteran. I would call Rigoberto a veteran. But there's something within myself, like after all of these years, that I can open that door and still access. But I think it takes many years of discipline to do that, to after your days of working and teaching and giving to other people, because I could say everybody on this panel, one thing that they all have in common is that they're givers. I don't even think we would all be here at the same time. We're all givers. We give to the community. We're all very heavily involved with community, that after that, there is a special place that you do have to open up to be able to give back to yourself. But I think that takes many years of discipline to do that.
Yeah, absolutely. I think my dear beloved teacher, Sister Sonia Sanchez, always tells a story of when she was raising her twins and professoring at Temple, and her writing time was that after everybody in the house had been fed and the babies were put to bed and the laundry was done and everything was done, it would be about midnight, and she would go to bed from 12 to 3, and she would rise at 3 and write from 3 to 6, and then she would go to the university. And this was how she lived for several years. So I think of her story, and I think of the story of Sister Lucille Clifton, another amazing angel who I was blessed to have as a teacher, who's told us about the fact that when she actually had five altogether, but there were four who were in diapers at once. This was before such a thing as a washing machine. And they called her to tell her about her which nomination was a Pulitzer or something. I think it was her Pulitzer nomination. They called her to tell her about it the day after her eviction with those four babies. And so she was at her friend's house and they couldn't find her. And then they had to track her down to tell her she was about to get this award for her writing. So I think about these stories when I think about, oh, it's hard today. Like, no, it's not.
Yeah, sure, sure.
Is there maybe one other question? I think because we have to stick to the time, is there one other sort of deep question that arises?
I love you. I love you for saying that, right?
I think if you have a best-selling novel, there certainly is a writer's life. If you can make millions doing this thing, you can just travel the world and say, I'm doing research for my next novel. There is no one writer's life is the answer. And I think, you know, that's kind of reflected in the makeup of the panel. And there's, I think for me, if there's a writer's life, and this kind of addresses your question too. I'm a capital P poet in the world, which means that I believe in, I have a particular mission. I work in the tradition of Luis Reyes Rivera, who is a cultural worker, right? Who came to poetry to do the hard work of filling in the gaps of history, right? So everything that I write, goes toward that. And whether I am in, indeed, reading your flood maps to determine if your property falls in a flood zone, or whether I am doing X, Y, and Z thing, there's always a process going on. Of how am I recording this? How am I turning this into a form? How am I? It's a little maddening, I will tell you. And especially if you're the empathetic sort that feels every single little thing everyone else is, you know, boy, it's a rough life. But I wouldn't trade it for the world, man. Like, this is it. And no matter what I'm doing, I'm always putting it toward that. That's why I say, you know, the writing muscle for me always has to be working. And I'm also an oppositionalist. My father always told me, don't do this thing and that thing at work too. Like, work with your hands and then do that. I tried that. It didn't work for me. You know. So that's the closest thing I got to a writer's life.
So I'm sure there are many questions which we can kind of hold in our hearts and minds, and we'll have time during the day, during lunch, during the reception to talk with each other about them. I want to thank, I've been very moved by everybody on this panel. It's just been great to hear you all. I thank you for speaking from your hearts and your experience, and thank you all for listening to us. Thank you so much.